see the change you wanna see.
Seaside is a caring, connected, and expanding spiritual community, sharing practical tools for richer living.
Just your heart to show you how you can be the change if you wanna.
We join in partnership with God to influence our lives for good, whether for improved health, finances, relationships, or simple happiness and joy.
Plant a flower, watch it grow. You will reap what you sow. You gotta keep the change. Be the change you wanna see.
Seaside is a caring, connected, and expanding spiritual community, sharing practical tools for richer living.
Just your heart to show you.
It is not ready. So it is ready. And here it is.
Be a preacher.
As a child, our whole life revolved around the church. I started preaching when I was 14. I was licensed at 15, ordained at 18.
He attended Oral Roberts University in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And Oral Roberts himself took Pearson under his wing.
Out of all the probably 25,000 students that had gone through there by the time he retired, no one had the kind of access to him as I did. He really literally treated me like his son.
You don't know like I know.
Fresh out of school, Bishop Pearson's popularity and message grew beyond anyone's expectations, including his own.
I was the first African-American preacher on the South Side to start a church that was integrated and maintained it to where it became what they would call a mega church in this town, up to about 4,000 or 5,000.
Bishop Pearson preached to millions all over the country. In 1995, he spoke alongside Reverend Billy Graham at the Oklahoma City bombing memorial.
The best for Oklahoma and America is still to come.
And was a spiritual advisor to President George H.W. Bush. But everything changed when Pearson had what he called a revelation from God.
I believe people go through hell, not ultimately to hell.
Stop telling people they're going to hell. I said, I don't care if they're sitting there with a needle in their arm, drunk, smoking a joint, HIV positive. Tell them their sins are forgiven. There's no issue between them and God that hasn't been resolved in Jesus. That's all I said.
If he didn't condemn, why do we?
His new message did not go over well with his congregation or with high-ranking church officials. Before he knew it, he had lost everything and was branded a heretic.
Preachers wrote letters denouncing it. I went from hero to zero and lost it all.
So that's a little bit on Carlton Pearce. Yeah. Carlton Pearson will be here on August 19th, and we will be showing this movie come Sunday, right after second service. We also have, what else do we have? Oh, open mic. So we've been doing open mic this summer, and we're not gonna have it this Wednesday, so you won't hear me sing and do my comedy skit. I know, but we will be having Sedema Interfaith Educational Forums is having Voices of Our City Choir and Documentary this Wednesday, August 8th from 6 to 8 p.m. And we have one last clip for you, and here it is.
Grew up in the hood down in New Orleans, so the music for me comes from the heart. The guitar was dedicated to the group.
This is the Voices of Our City, which is comprised of homeless citizens, our homeless neighbors, and those who desire to help.
So hopefully it'll bring some money in for Voices in Our City. This is Richard Melvin.
I have a published book out, My Life as a Poet.
Your powerful words and the emotion I'm able to capture.
Wow.
Huh?
Great.
We collaborated,
great.
Huh?
Great.
It was great. They're so genuine and so such sweet people. That's why I decided to document them.
What this choir is doing is giving voice to the voiceless.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to invite up the Voices of Our City Choir.
My husband got locked up. That made us homeless because all the money that we had actually saved just went to lawyers and was gone.
I worked at a Fortune 500 company. I ended up on the street.
All right, and that's this Wednesday. And last for my announcement this morning is after second service at 3 p.m., we will be here doing a celebration of life for Sandy Atkinson. So just come out and show up, and we're going to celebrate Sandy for all that she did in her life, and it's going to be just a memorable evening for us all. So with all that being said, we may now stand and greet our neighbors.
For the congregational song, which is going to be led by our very own Carl Anthony, everybody.
Hey, what's going on, everybody?
Yeah.
All right, keep standing. Come on, no, this is a congregational. We got to stand like a choir. Here we go. So, all right, so now, here, this is one of the, you don't have to look up there, because I want you to look at each other. Here's the deal. So it's one of those call and response. So repeat after me. Let your light.
Let your light.
Try better. Come on now. Let
your light
shine bright.
Shine bright.
I think you got it. Yeah, you're good. All right. Are you guys ready over there? All right. How about this band, huh? One, two, three. Come on, let's go.
Let your light
shine bright
through the dark
light of the night.
The night.
Let your love
be strong.
Say
I belong
in this song. Let me hear you.
Let your heart
let go.
Free your mind.
Got to know. Yeah, let your light.
Shine bright,
beyond the dark,
in plain sight.
Now
let it go,
go,
go.
It's got to go.
Let
the past go,
go.
Let it go,
go,
go.
It's got to go.
Let your past go. Let me hear you.
Let your light.
Shine bright
through the dark
of the night.
Yeah,
let your love
be strong.
Say I belong
in this.
Now look at somebody.
Let your heart
let go.
Free your mind.
Got to know. Yeah, let your light
shine bright.
on the dock.
Be on the dock.
In plain sight. Bob! Give that man a big round of applause. Time for letting go.
Now's the time for letting go.
Take it to the dance floor.
Take it to the dance floor.
Don't hold on to it so tight.
Hold on to it so tight.
Letting it go, go feels right.
Letting go, go feels right.
Now's the time for letting go.
Now's the time for letting go.
Take it to the dance floor.
Don't
hold on to it so tight.
Don't hold on to it so tight.
Letting it go, go feels right.
Let it go, go feels right.
Let
your light
shine bright.
Shine bright.
Through the dark.
Through the dark.
Of the night.
Of the night.
Yeah, let your love.
Let your love.
Be strong.
Be strong.
Say, I belong.
I belong.
In this song. Let it go,
let it go,
go, go,
go, go.
It's got to go,
it's got to go.
Let your past go, go, let it go,
let it go,
go, go. Here we go,
go, go.
It's got to go,
it's got to go.
Together, let the past go, go,
go.
Hey, Carl Anthony! Woo! That is the perfect song today. That is the whole message about to let the past go, let the light shine in the darkness, let your love be strong. I love it. I love it. Obviously, Carl's just back from vacation because he's just chilled. And it's like, you two are having fun up there. I haven't seen like guys kind of turn on like that.
Yeah, it was a pleasure when Carl's here.
Yeah, it's fun. And it's always joy when you're here.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, that's right.
Thank you.
Right.
So,
thank Jade.
Love my Seaside family.
Yeah, we love you. That's for sure. We're blessed. We're blessed. Hey, good morning, Seaside. Woo! What a joy it is to be with you today. It's a wonderful summer day where we have come to let our light shine, shine. The past, go, go, go. And just there's life here. It could be because it's Interfaith Awareness Week. Yeah, I don't know about that. But anyway, this Interfaith Awareness Week, you know, it's a lot of the mayors in San Diego County. I think there's eight. I got it written out how many there are. But there's a lot of mayors in our cities. And most of them have indicated that and wrote a proclamation to support this Interfaith Week and to educate that, you know what, we're all talking about this life force. We're all talking about the let the past go, go, go. Let the light shine. Let the love heal. And if we can transcend the rhetoric and the words, we'll find that we're talking about the same spirit. And so Wednesday, actually every day this week, there are these interfaith experiences. And there's this inner city choir that's coming here on Wednesday night. So it's pretty cool. I invite you to come be part of it. There's no cost to it, and it's going to be a powerful night. But I'll tell you what's powerful. It's right now, because we're here for this, and this happening is going to be divine. It's going to be exciting. It's going to be God expressed. So if you're here for the first time, hold on, because we're going to blast off. And also know that you're welcome, whoever you are, wherever we are on our path. This is a place that cares and loves. And so we do our best to not have judgment and realize that we're all learning, growing, and grooving on this thing called life and doing our best that we can. So we're here to support each other. Pick us up when we're down. Share our joy when we're up, and just be here as a spiritual community. How does that sound? Yes. And it's fun to have this corner going again. It's fun to see, you know, Robin back in the house, Reverend Tammy back in the house, Reverend Rick Mars back in the house. Woo! And so things have not changed. We still believe it's spirit first always as much as we can get going. We've got a wonderful practitioner today, Patty Christensen, past president to our practitioner core, and wonderful storyteller. Take us there.
Good morning. I invite you to sit back in your chair, wiggle around a little bit, and join me in a moment of stillness.
Thank you.
know there is one amazing power, one divine, all-powerful spirit from which all flows, one amazing web that connects everything, everyone, and all good. I know I am a part of that spirit. I am a human being who has come living a spiritual life, living in this body, being here on purpose right now. And as I know that for me, I know and I affirm and accept it for each person here that today we have a divine gathering of people come by divine perfect appointment, spiritual beings coming together in the power. It is good. And so I speak my words of truth that today's service is here on purpose, that each person who showed up here today, who is on the way, and who is there with live streaming and coming, this is a divine appointment. Come now and bring your whole self. I know that spirit is alive here, that each person speaking, each person singing, the band, the persons who are serving to make this day are blessed, and it is good, it is right, it is perfect. I know Reverend Dr. Christian's words are on fire as he brings the words directly to each heart here, where each one comes, brings anything that is unhealed, anything that they suffer for, and place it down and let the past go. Today is good and right and perfect. I'm thankful for the good that is here and the good that it is on the way.
All is well, and I am grateful. All is well, and now it's time to let it go. All is well, and I am grateful. Life is good, and so it is. All is well, and I am grateful. All is well, and now it's time to let it go. All is well, and I am grateful. Life is good, and so it is. God is good, and so it is.
Yes, it is so good. Whew. Thank you, Rebecca and Max on the piano, for really dropping us in, and for practitioner Patty for getting us there, and of course, the amazing Mr. Anthony for getting us moving. Let's keep it going, guys. Good morning, family. My name is Audra Nicole. For those of you who don't know me, I am a practitioner here at Seaside. I'm a member of your practitioner core council. I am a co-facilitator of the Next Gen Retreat, and I am currently an applicant for our ministerial and master's program. So lots of exciting things going on. If this is your first Sunday with us, welcome, extra welcome, because I've never said welcome to you before, and I love you already. And just to show you how excited we are to have you, we have these incredible welcome packets. If you walk out the door, right on your right-hand side, there's a lot of them there. Anyone wearing these beautiful green sashes are licensed practitioners. They probably have some answers for you if you have questions, and they can also pray for you. So let's get started. Today I'm reading from Tam McKeeve's book, Inspired and Unstoppable. She's going to be joining us here in a couple weeks. When I'm chomping at the bit to get there already, it's my ego and it's fear. It's insecurity that's eager to prove itself, get somewhere and be somebody. But the truth is serene within me. It smiles as big as the sky, and it knows the outcome. Truth says, I know you want to speed things up a bit. Well, I don't. Hey, you're in the dream birth canal. I want to make sure you develop lungs and kidneys and nose hairs and every one of your precious reaching toes. Of course, I'm not suggesting you just wait. I'd prefer you step out of time altogether. Stop counting seconds or years. Fall in love with the task in front of you until you remember who you really are and you tremble and you burn with freedom. The results are not in the future. They're in you this second. There's no place to rush to. Believe you me, a dead body on a fast train will never arrive in the promised land. Timing is about awakening to another state of mind, letting go of numbness, fear, and limits. You don't get somewhere new. You become someone new. And everything you need comes to you. Time is love.
Ooh, that's a good word this morning, huh? Yeah. Good morning, Seaside. It is a beautiful day. Wow. Well, it is my honor, as it is on Sunday mornings, to introduce our guest artist. And I know you all love him. I love him too. We're so grateful when he's here. We already got a taste of his beautiful spirit, his beautiful energy this morning. I wanted to share with you a little bit of something that he's got going on. In the beginning parts of next year, he is planning a trip to Thailand and to India. So if that's something that you wanna tag along with Carl, please see him after the service. He has information about that. He also has CDs. He has some things that are there to support the children that he helps to support and keep them in, you know, positive and all that good stuff. So please see him after the service. And today, without further ado, let's get a little bit of more special love from our very own Carl Anthony.
Thank you, Rebecca. Wow, thank you so much. Hi, everybody. Well, my goodness, you know, today, this great talk that you're about to experience from Reverend Christian is reminded me of, I remember the movie Where Dreams May Come, and it reminded me of art, you know, this all the color that was in that movie, if you haven't seen it. But and when I'm in the hospital, when I'm working with kids, I'll say, what's your favorite color? And they'll say either pink or purple. And so I have a song called Purple. But I thought it would be just perfect for before the Christian's talk. And so, but there's one part, I don't know if you know this, but I love it when people sing with me. What? So I have one part. It's very, very simple. It's this yo-ho. Okay? So your part is very simple like this. It goes, yo-ho! That's your part, okay? So, now go look at the person next to you and say, it's going to be fine. It's going to be okay. All right, okay. So let's try it together. Ready? Here we go. Yo-ho! Fantastic. Give yourself a hand. Hey! garland to celebrate her wedding day. And he was such a darling, for he loved her more than he could say. And when they met, he gave her a flower between the colors of blue and red. It was a day love turned purple. It was a day purple spread. Come on. Yo ho. Now they had many children who were born with purple eyes. Their special gifts are healing. They are young and they are wise. They see the world with purple vision between the color of blue and red. They live in one decision. See purple and let it spread. See purple and let it spread. Yo ho! Love turned purple the day they wed. When you see purple, let it spread. Love turned purple the day they wed. When you see purple, let it spread. Anytime you see. Celebrate her wedding day. And she says he's still a darling, for he loves her more than he could say. And when they die, they'd like some flowers between the colors of blue and red. They're ready for their very last hour to slay the flowers around their heads. Purple flowers around their heads. Come on, yo. Be longer. Here we go. One, two, three. Yo ho! Dr. Reverend Christian, right there.
Mr. Carl Anthony. Woo! All right. Man, that is. Another great song for this movie, because as Carl shared, it's a full-on Technicolor kind of experience where the colors just pop out of the screen, and purple plays an important part of this movie. And so if you don't know what we've been doing at Seaside this summer, is we've been going through movies that carry with it this hidden spiritual message. Actually, some movies aren't so hidden, like this one's just blatantly out there. And it went mainstream about afterlife, reincarnation, and connection. And it's a wonderful movie, one of my favorites, but it's like 20 years ago. And Robin Williams hit it out of the park again with this one. It's very complicated to explain. So good luck in following me as I embark upon this very colorful journey that started off with a young Robin Williams in a little sailboat skip on the lakes in Switzerland. Beautiful mountains, greenery in the background, catching the wind on this little sailboat, this one-person boat, and he's sailing along, and another little skiff sailboat runs into him, and
Robin Williams, probably about college age, and this other girl in the other boat just starts giggling as she bumps into him. Just, you know, the silly kind of giggles going on. And she's probably college age, too. They're out in the middle of the water, in the middle of Switzerland, beautiful mountains. What would you expect? But them, like, getting together on the shore, and she pulls off her red scarf, and she brings out her picnic baskets because guys just don't think about those things, you know. We got to eat. Oh, I didn't think about that. So she shares her sandwich, and it's just, it's magical. You can see the chemistry. They're just two beautiful people, fall in love, undoubtedly soulmates that just somehow found each other in the middle of the Swiss Alps, and it was like destiny. And so the intro of the movie is there laughing and giggling, getting married, spraying each other with hoses, washing the cars, and they have a little girl and a little boy, and they're growing up. You see them having breakfast together. Everybody's happy. The kids are going off to school. Mom, will you drive us? No. Carpool today, or the nanny will take you. They kiss her goodbye. They drive off. Boom. Things change instantly. The two kids are killed. So much for all the color in that movie. And then the credits roll, the beginning of the movie. That's all before the movie began. And it's hard. I mean, the mom undoubtedly is devastated. In there you see the two coffins at the funeral. And mom goes into a deep depression. And she just doesn't come out of that depression. It's dark. She's institutionalized. She's in a trance. She's lost. It's her fault for not taking them. And all the things of horror that you could imagine is where she's lost. And the thing about the voice of God is that it's love. And it's not being heard in that moment. And sometimes when somebody does something or feels bad and they can no longer hear that voice of love that's saying, you know, this too will pass. We're going to come through this. It's going to be okay. And it's not that everything we do in our life is right or that there isn't some nasty things out there in the world, but the true nature of our being, no matter what has happened, is one of innocence. At least that's how you were born into this world. That is the truth of who you are, no matter what has transpired. And a miracle worker is one who is able to look at you and continue to see that original innocence and that beauty and that expression of the divine, even when you can't see it yourself. Because what happens sometimes is when we blunder or make a mistake or we get lost in the depression or the darkness that Carl was singing about, and all of a sudden we begin to believe that is the truth of our being, it begins difficult to hear. We have fallen into a dream and a nightmare that we dream the dream of our lack or our inadequate self or our guilt self or our shame self or our angry self, and it continues to be perpetuated. But that miracle worker is one who can enter into that darkness and remember that original innocence, the truth of your being. And that voice of love is what sings. That voice of love is what we were singing about earlier, that we bring in to the situation that is at hand. And when something goes wrong, you know, God isn't trying to make somebody wrong. What God does is they choose to see the innocence, as opposed to the human tendency wants to punish someone. It is about saying, you know what, you're an expression of spirit here. And in any moment, at any given moment, things can turn around. That's the beauty of this universe. It is primed to turn around. It's primed to turn around on the spot and say, you know what? Things can change now. There's a new opportunity. There's something else that is emerging here. But you're the one who's got to see that and know that. And Robin Williams, his name is Chris. Christy is what his wife would call him. He was calling her out the best he could, and she just could not see that. He tried, and he tried for 4 years. You see him visiting her in the institute, and she just could not come out. Eventually, he said, you know, it's got to do something. She's out. She's doing her art. She's painted this beautiful picture of landscape of their dream home, trying to vision, right? And you put that ideal heavenly vision of a house and the waterfalls and the hills and the colors. Looked like a Monet picture of this tree with no leaves on it and a man just standing with the wind blowing at his back. And she was an artist, and she has a museum, and the artist didn't have the art to show, and she calls him, Christy, what do I do? He says, I'll go pick up this other artist, and you can show your painting here too. And he gets in the car, and he starts going. It's nighttime, crossing the bridge, and there's an accident, and cars are tumbling all over the place, and he's a doctor, And so he gets out his car to go help this one lady in the car and is hanging upside down. And he steps back as another car comes flying through the air from the accident and crushes him. Talk about rough, losing your two kids. Now she loses her husband. And Robin Williams, it's like right out of our textbooks. You know, he hovers above his body, looks down. Hey, what's going on down there? And next thing you know, he's sitting in the operating room on the ceiling looking down. Say, hey, come on, let's go. And he just couldn't grasp the concept that he has died. He's like, he's trying to make this transition, or he's not trying. He's trying to stay, and there's something that is moving him on. And so he has a guide, if you would, show up to assist him. It was like the only person in his life he would ever listen to was another doctor. His name was Dr. Albert. And he was an older African-American guy who he would listen to and take guidance from. And he had already made his transition. And he's saying, come on, Chris, we got to go. He said, I'm never leaving. I can't leave my wife. She's in pain. She's going to think it's horrible. And he kept going back to visit her. And when you're going back to visit somebody, you know, because you're feeling bad or guilt or what have you, you bring that with you. And so he would touch her face at the funeral, and she would feel it, and she would scream. It's like she couldn't be free because it was kept being not visited from an unconditional love. It was more being visited from something that had not yet let go of. So Dr. Albert's saying, Chris, you got to move on. You got to move on. And that's one of the things I believe about nature is that, you know, when we arrive into this world, we've got people to kind of get us going here on this vibration, right? They're called parents. We have guides. You could call them spirit guides if you're on the other side because you're not really sure who they are, but they're going to guide you. I believe that nature takes care of things just as normally as when you come into this world as when you step out. And you've got those individuals who assist you. And what Albert says to Chris as he's trying to figure out this what's going on, he says, you create the space that you're comfortable with. You know, which means, you know, you got the people you relate to. That's why some people will see the long, blonde, flowing hair Jesus with the blue eyes, the surfer dude Jesus of the West that will bring them comfort. And some will see the Middle Eastern Jesus. And some will see the little blue Krishna with his flute playing around because that's what brings them comfort. Others will see Dad or Mom or Uncle George or whoever it is, but we tend to enter into a space that we can surrender into the process because it really is not going back. Life is about moving forward. And so Robin wakes up, or Chris wakes up in this picture that his wife has been painting. But now it's 3D Technicolor. The purples are jumping out. He grabs a blue flower and the paint just melts in his hand. The water is running. The green is vivid. And out of the brush comes his dog that had died, you know, some years before to greet him in this world, jumps on him, starts licking his face, this Dalmatian, and it's like, Katie, Katie, oh my goodness, I must have screwed up. I'm in dog heaven. And as he begins to take a grip of things, he said, this is heaven. I think you're in my heaven because that is the transition. And so he's trying to grasp, and he says, Albert, I don't understand. You know, it's so beautiful here. You know, is it like this everywhere? You know, like, where are my kids? And he said, this place is large enough so everybody can have their own universe. Until you've become comfortable here, you're able to go somewhere else. He said, well, can I start moving through this world? Well, he said, as soon as you think you can. Sounds like metaphysics, doesn't it? It's like trying to get yourself working here. You know, once you think you can, it's kind of change your thinking, change your life kind of thing. You know, once you think you can. Same thing there, same dimension, same principle. Once you know it, you can begin to move through this world. And he's starting to look around, and he sees this tree in the picture that had no leaves on, and all of a sudden, it is this vivid purple. It has this profusion of purple leaves, just larger than the stage. And he said, but that wasn't like that in the picture. How's that possible that this tree is filled with purple leaves? As we were saying, you know, the color of love, love being expressed. And Albert says, I don't know. It's your picture, but it's just my wife's painting. He said, I've never seen this before. It looks like your wife is communicating through the painting, through the different dimensions. I have never seen this take place before. You two must be soulmates, twin flames. And he just takes off towards that picture. And he tries to run on water, and he sinks. And he shouts out as he goes underneath the water. He says, Albert, I'm drowning. He says, how can you drown? You're already dead. Oh, yeah. And he gets to that tree. And he says, you know, Annie, I love you. Annie, and just screams and cries it out. You can feel the passion. And it's the passion, it's the love that transcends time and space. It is why I share with people, you're closer than a phone call now, guys. If they're on the other side, you just have to learn to communicate through the new vehicle. And it's not because you paint purple leaves. It is because there's a heart there. There's a feeling that keeps you connected. But she was not yet ready and receptive. She's still sitting in the guilt, still sitting in the unworthiness, still sitting in the shame, still sitting in, it's my fault that I had him get the pictures. It's my fault I set the kids. And when she felt his love touch her through the multidimensional space, she just started screaming and crying, just couldn't take it. Just erased all the purple. He just sat there and cried. He said, Albert, I want to see my kids. When am I going to see my kids? He says, you're going to see your kids when you see your kids. What? Kind of like a Wayne Dyer thing. You don't see it till you believe it, right? When are you going to see my kids? When you see your kids, right? Once again, we come back. When you get it, when you can see it, when you can feel it, when you can vision it, when you, when it's you, that's when you're going to see it. He didn't quite say it like that, but, I would have. Anyway, so he said, start thinking of your daughter. And he thought of his daughter and the beautiful kind of fairy, not fairy village, more like a Taj Mahal with steps and things and like goddesses and people flying and floating in the air. And what he was remembering was that scene from his daughter's like little play station. I don't know what they call it. It's like, but, and he enters into this beautiful colored place. And he's greeted by this like Asian airline attendant who's walking him through all this kind of mystical looking surrounding and takes him down to a boat like a gondola and they start to push off. And she says, and what do you remember about your daughter? And he begins to describe this scene when he was playing with her, in this little goddessy flying people cherub kind of atmosphere that was like he was in that. And he said, my daughter said to me, that how much fun she enjoyed playing with me because I never did. And I said, well, I will play this game with you until you win. And she said, and did she ever win? He said, no. She never won. I kept playing with her. And he looked. And he said, Marie, is that you? And he looks into this woman's eyes and realizes that this is his daughter. And she said, Dad, when you took me to Asia and we got on the airlines and there was this Asian woman in her flight attendant outfit, you said how beautiful she was, how gracious she was, how gentle, how intelligent. And I just wanted to be that for you. And he didn't even see it until his heart was ready, until he was ready. And in our life, until we are ready, things aren't going to shift. We're not going to see it until we see it. And we may think it's somewhere else, but we're dealing with a vibrational frequency of an omnipresence life force, which is the presence of God, whose voice is love. And love is what will bring light to the darkness. Love is what will transform it. And the miracle worker's job is to continue to reach out to those that have lost their contact because they have forgotten their true innocence or the truth of who they are. They are caught up in the perceptual realm. They're caught up in the realm of the physical senses, forgetting that who they are is more than that. And with that, we can slip into fear, and fear is a natural state. Who hasn't experienced the terror of fear at some time in their life? And the natural question is when you're in that place of loss or fear, it's like, and how? What do I do? How do I get out of this if my original state is one of the innocence and the voice of God is love? And I got to tell you, it's pretty simple, but not easy. And that is, when you are gripped by the fear within your mind, is to remember that God is all things, that the reality is spirit, that God is life and God is your life. And being that God is your life, there is nothing you need to fear. That spirit is your source, that is your expression. And when you can come into that, you can sink into a lake and realize I can't die. I can walk across the bottom. I can transcend from this physical body and I will be shown the way into a greater state of beingness. And all of a sudden you begin to have that shift in your life. You know, peace and poise is the most direct route home. If you want. Meister Eckhart said that it is a lie if you're talking about God and you don't feel comfort. That's a good one, guys. It's a lie if you're talking about God and you don't feel comfort, because you're not feeling that presence. You're not feeling that experience. And when you have within your heart a sense of worthiness of that which is in that heart, in that soul, you will have the universe prove that is the truth of who you are. That it will prove the truth of your life. You got that? When you have within your heart, just as Annie, Chris's wife, couldn't get it, she didn't have it. It wasn't in her heart. It wasn't in her soul. It wasn't within her being at that time to be able to know that there's something greater possible here. And maybe you got your act together, but it doesn't mean Spirit's not going to whack you again, because I'll tell you what, Dr. Albert comes to Chris and says, Annie's died. She's taken her own life. And I don't necessarily agree with how they extrapolate the concept of suicide within this movie, because I don't think you're bound there for eternity or however long. But for the movie's sake, it said that she's going to be there. He said, well, I'll go get her. I love her. He says, you can't. I've never seen anybody brought back from that kind of position. And hell is not a place where there's fire and there's pain. It is a state in which one is living in and is stuck. Which, agree with that one. He said, but I got to go. He says, Chris, nobody can get there and come back. He says, I'm going. You know, I'm going to go. You said persistence is the key. I'm going to persist. I'm going to get there. You said there's no rules. I'm going to persist, and there's no rules, so I can do it. And has anybody ever told you being over-persistent is stupid? But he persisted. So we got to get you a tracker. So he went out and got himself a tracker to take him to hell. And the way you get there is you feel the love of the person that is stuck there in the story. And that the tracker can feel the connectionness and find the way there. And so in this mystical floating ship is the tracker, is Chris, is Dr. Albert. And they head on down into the darkness and all these places. And they end up like at the gates of hell. Shipwrecks and fire and brimstone. They're not quite in there. And the guide says, you're not thinking about your wife. You're thinking about something else. We can't enter those gates and find her unless you begin to feel her and love her. What is it you're thinking about? I said, my son. I haven't seen my son. I said, well, what are you thinking about? He said, I was thinking how I never really listened to him. I was remembering this last conversation I had with him. It was pouring rain. And I said, if I was in the worst trouble, if I had to go through hell, I'd want nobody next to me more than my son, than you. And he looked at Dr. Albert and realized that was his son. That all of a sudden, he transformed into a state and realized he's been with him the whole time. He said, but why did you take that? He said, because, Dad, you never listened to me. He said, actually, Dad, you never listened to anybody but Dr. Albert. He said, well, you can't come with me in here. That's because they said there's probably no coming back from this. And he said, Dad, I want to go. He said, you can't go. He said, then listen to me this time. He said, don't listen to the tracker who says you can't go and stay there any longer than 3 minutes. Listen to your heart. Listen to that. And with that, they go on in with the tracker and Chris, and they go into the dark pits of the darkness. And it goes from, you know, technicolor down to gray, drab, monochromatic, yuck. And they see his house that Annie and Chris lived in, but it was decrepit, it was gray, it was old, it was cracked, the roof was in, it was a mess. And the tracker says, if you go in there, you've got 3 minutes. More than 3 minutes, you're going to get to the edge. And if you go into her world, you're never going to come back into your world. You're going to have to give up and come back out
after the 3 minutes. He said, okay. And he went on in. He found Annie lying on the floor in her trance, despondent, caught up in her mistakes or failures or guilt or whatever things we run through our mind, but it just never ends. It's a continual looping kind of thing. You're not available to the miracle worker that has entered in to bring the love and to bring the light and said, there's another option here. Remember, the universe is primed to make things new. There's new opportunities. And he enters in and she says, who are you? And he said, I'm a neighbor. I just moved into the neighborhood. He looked around and said, where are your paintings? Maybe this place could use a little paint here, you know, a little bit of color, you know. And he said, you remind me of somebody, she said. He said, did you know my husband? He said, my wife, she committed suicide. And she lost a couple kids. And she's lost. I've come to find her and to bring her to bring her back to the light and to the color of the world. He said, I was married, you know? And she screams and kind of gets up and says, no. I said, it's okay, it's okay. I just want you to know that I'm so sorry for all the things I'm not going to be able to bring you anymore, the meatball sandwiches, to make you smile, and all the things I've wanted to do, is grow old with you, have our body parts fall apart, you know? You know, I just want to say I apologize for all the times I failed you, in particular this particular time of not being able to bring you back. I thank you for our kids. And she screams, kind of gets up, and it's nuts. And he walks outside as he could feel himself starting to get lost. And he walks back outside to the tracker and says, you're right. I had to give up. But not in the way you think. I'm giving up out here. I'm going back in. Tell my children I love them, but I'm going to be with their mother. Marv, you want to run that scene?
I can find her. Good people end up in hell because they can't forgive themselves. You tell my children I love them. And I won't leave their mother.
Stay. Christy.
What happened to this place? It's gone.
Imagine a hell bringing your soulmate into that place and knowing they're going to experience that pain. You know, we spoke about a couple weeks about Lao Tzu, who said it's in caring that we find the courage. It's our willingness to be okay in the uncertainty. So much we want the certainty, we want the answers. But those that are going on a journey will find destinations their soul had no way of knowing. And what happened from here is in that whiteness they woke up together. That he brought her or she brought him back to their painting in the technicolor, in the brightness, in their house, in their home, in the joy. The kids returned and there is love and there's just happiness and everything is just heaven in their experience. And Robin says to Annie, but you know, the one thing we don't have here is the ability to find each other and fall in love again. Let's go back to Earth. Yeah. She said, how are you going to find me?
He said, if I can find you in hell, I can find you in Jersey. And besides, the time's different here. While we're gone, it's just a heartbeat, and we'll be back with our kids. And so, but how are they going to return? Marv? Start at 120, Marv.
I want it all. As long as it's with you.
When I was young, I met this beautiful girl by a lake.
Dreaming's good, but waking up is better. God bless us as we wake up into our dreams. I love you. Hey, let's keep it going as we bring Carl Anthony back to our stage for a little bit more love.
Take a deep breath. That's beautiful, huh? You know, when before a service, you know, I'll have a conversation with Christian and we'll talk about, so what are you gonna put out there? And he told me about this movie, and I remember that movie so amazing. It's very impactful. And it reminded me so much of a song that I wrote for my mother 25 years ago as she was going through cancer and making her passing. And that was such a long time ago, and I haven't sung it in a long time, so I'm going to sing it for you now. It's called Loving Arms. 1, 2, 3, 4.
And it will bless my
my life. So please, if you must go, then let me know. Where will I feel your loving arms? If you must go, then let me know. Please let me feel your loving arms. Decision's been made, and I am less than willing. So, if you must go, then let me know. Where will I feel your loving arms? If you must go, then let me know. Must go, then let me know. Please let me feel your loving eyes. If you must go, then let me know. Please let me feel your loving eyes.
That is Carl Anthony. Loving arms, boy. I remember that time in your life, Carl. Mm-hmm.
Me
it's
too.
Beautiful. I remember the big concert you did, Del Mar Hilton in her honor.
Well, you do remember. Yeah.
I do. I mean, we were there. That was very special, very heartfelt. Hey, this is the time of our service where we have the opportunity to unite together, to feel those loving arms of God, knowing that that voice of Spirit is what remembers our innocence, our wholeness. It is that love that transcends time and space. It is that something that allows us to be connected with those we love that moved on before us. For truly, without this dimension frequency, the time away, as they were saying in the movie, it's a heartbeat. You know, it only seems distance here because this is the realm where the distance is. But when we deal in heart and soul and consciousness, we're there. And so what we get to do with those that we love that moved before us is to practice that as a gift they're still giving us now, is to feel that multidimensional expression of life. So with that thought, I want to thank you up front for your support of with your love to support this community as we continue to grow and to thrive and to expand and to fulfill Spirit's vision for us. And so I want to say thank you to you, and know that this is the time of our service where we have the opportunity to give our support in a financial way to allow that love to pour forth in a way that is able to assist us in functioning within this world. And so as you give, it comes back. But it's not why you give. You give because that's who you are. It's an extension of your consciousness. It's a level in which Spirit is manifesting in your life, and that's what reciprocates back. That is what you're experiencing. It's not the words, but it is that which you practice. So with that, I want to invite our ushers to come forward and say thank you to this wonderful crew. Thank you to those that mail in your contributions when you cannot be here on a Sunday, those who stick them in my pocket when they get here on a Sunday, those of you that are at home watching our live streaming, thank you for your support and your love. It allows us to continue doing what it is we do. We're working on getting a wider bandwidth so we don't shake on our way out, no matter where in the world you may be.
So with that, I want to share this prayer of gratitude with the most generous of spiritual communities, knowing that this truly is a blessed moment where the divine unfolds its expression through each and every one of us. For the grace and the divine emanation of God has its way as our very experience in this moment. For truly our life has been blessed just for the fact that we can sit here in this beautiful place with a spiritual community feeling this love. Our life is blessed with love, a love that transcends this time and space, a love that is far-reaching. It is a love that is truly an emanating expression that moves from the very soul in the center of being, which is the residing place of that infinite, omnipresent allness of life itself. And with that, the healing happens, the transformation happens, the loving arms are felt that surround us. So with joy, we have been blessed with this gift that we are about to share. We share it with a sense of appreciation, being able to know that we pass forth these blessings, and these blessings go forth into life, bringing the joy and the love to everyone it comes in contact. Thank you, Father, Mother, God, for this opportunity to be the activity that Spirit has in our individual lives. And so we give from love, and we live in love with a sensitive security and peace, knowing we live as a wonderful expression of the infinite, and so it is. Amen. Together, let us say this affirmation of abundance, which is, Spirit continues to bless my world. Gratefully, I live as the giving expression of Spirit, opening the floodgates of the affluent flow of greater good as my life now. You guys from Seaside. Nice job. And so as I stand before this bounty, I can feel the love pouring forth in this very moment. For as we have opened our heart and our soul, we can just be that wonderful conduit of the divine emanation that enriches and blesses the vortex through which it passes. And what I know right now is that passage brings with it the grace and the wonder, the abundance, the joy, and the ease in our individual lives. And so we share this gift knowing it is making a difference. And so it is received in love. It is handled in good stewardship. And we send it forth, allowing it to continue to make the difference in our lives of all those it touch. Thank you, Father, Mother, God, for this opportunity to be part of this wonderful emanation of abundant good. And so it is. Amen. All right. Hey, this is Tasha Manzano. She is one of your board members here at Seaside. And just thank you for all your support and your love. Heard you're heading up another like picnic kind of thing, a board party at the end of September, too. So that's going to be fun. Thank you for your wonderful orchestration of our food. And fun. Food and fun. That's Tasha. All right. Hey, Carl, Anthony, wonderful. Nice job. You can sit here. You can come all the way up here if you want. It's like up front seat, sitting next to our very own Rebecca, who's always rocking our house. We love you and appreciate you, and just thank you for the wonderful orchestration of Sunday mornings. And thank you, Audra, who's entering into that school of ministry. Congratulations. Very exciting. Hey, giving us sound today is Steve, visuals is Marv, and a big shout out to the Crawford crew. Thank you, guys, and just how wonderful to have that support that is there. And you guys at home, we know you're there. Keep sending in those emails and those texts. It's a joy to be able to deliver this message and know that we're reaching beyond our campus that's here. So, hey, lots going on at Seaside. Take a look at Sunday program. You know, what we got going on today, which is really the heartfelt experience here at Seaside, is Sandy Atkinson, one of the charter members of Seaside, made her transition. And it's just a big hit for our community, for sure. Really the one who led us in going green and being ecologically minded and community gardens and spearheading the charge or idea of solar on the roof, or no longer use of paper goods here, but rather water is more environmentally correct as opposed to what it takes to produce a paper plate, which people don't, I'd rather throw it away. But, you know, there is no way. And she has left a lasting legacy, and we're remembering her today at 3 o'clock. Truly a forerunner of that kind of ecologically thinking. She's part of a president of Noun, which is National Organization of Women. I mean, I could keep going on, but I'm going to do that at 3. Her friends are going to be here. It's going to be a wonderful celebration. So I encourage you, if you want, if people in from out of town, and it's just a special Remembrance Day. So that's going on. Wednesday, you know, the Interfaith, I mentioned to you earlier, but I'll say it again. Wednesday night, we've got this choir. You've probably seen them on our local TV, the news picking them up. They're here Wednesday night, so come be part of that. Pick up your tickets for James Von Prague. You know, VIPs go quick. You know, I don't know what it is, but they're close to being halfway sold out. Those are the first ones to go. So it'll be here in September, but you grab your ticket now. On the 19th, you saw Carlton Pearson. He's going to be here. That'll be phenomenal and free. We're showing his movie afterward. He's answering questions. We're going to have food, so stick around and be part of that. Then Tama Keeves. After that, she'll do a workshop. She's got a new book, just great stuff. And then on September 2nd, Reverend Tammy is going to be speaking here on Sunday morning, so mark your calendar. So lots going on, and so take a look at the program, because I forget a lot of it, so you don't even know what I'm missing. But anyway, what I want to do is pray. Healing is the thrust of our movement since its conception. We believe in moving it from the realm of thought into the realm of form. We believe in being that conduit for spirit to have its way. And so what I want to do in this moment is get myself out of the way. I want to invite any of our religious science practitioners that are present to stand and let all of us feel this upliftment of that divine emanation, of that wonderful energy, of that good juju of spirit that is moving here in this moment. It is a blessing, and it is wonderful, and it is God, and it is happening. Feel that life force, that laughter, that good expression for spirit and its joy and its abundance and its ease is the natural state from which we are created. Choose to feel this divine download in this moment and feel the love that is present. For that love that brings light to the darkness, the love that heals all things. I need not tell spirit what to do. What I do is become receptive. I become that place where God is known and felt. And it is in that place that I enter into the technicolor, this wonderful vibration, this frequency, this life force, where healing happens. For that intelligence that guides the universe absolutely knows what it can do with my life. And so I get my little thinking out of the way, thinking I'm just a one-dimensional, two-dimensional kind of expression, but realizing that I am multidimensional, that I am not bound by time and space. What I am is awareness, and I am able to know greater than what I have known within my mind. I am able to know that I am more than my body. I'm able to know that I am that place that spirit is, and it is in this deep knowing that the shift takes place. For this universe is primed to bring forth that which is new. Multiple opportunities, and I choose to step into the next greatest, highest expression of that which is mine to do. And as I say yes to that motion, that movement of God, the healing happens, because there is the motion and the movement of God within my life, purging out that which does not belong, healing that which seems stuck or constricted or fear-bound, and it leaves me available to a greater possibility, to that innate, initial innocence of being. And when I return to the wonderful state or frequency of that from which I was created, anything unlike it falls away. I become an attracting factor for greater good, and abundance flows. Those places that have been ones of challenge begin to give way to an opening in the flow of spirit. Live with a sense of success and fulfillment and contentment and joy and creativity. Not resting and saying this is it, but knowing that there is more that is yet to be through me, through you, through each and every one of us, through Seaside. For Seaside continues to be a representation of the collective emerging consciousness of greater participation within this world. Abundance is the natural state to live in, and all that is necessary to fulfill that vision that continues to fill itself out is already in place, showing up. We have the eyes to see and the courage to say yes. I know every prayer request that has been brought forth to our treatment request chest is now fulfilled. For our beloved Reverend Rick Mars, whose mom made her transition this week, we know she moves on with those wonderful states of eternality. And that Rick is surrounded with a love and a support and an ability to rest upon the faith and the truth that he knows, knowing that he and mom are still connected as she is able to express herself in a vehicle that is more expressive and mobile than it had been. The world is richer because of the light that she brought, and it shines through Rick. And so today is a day of grace. I'm grateful for the love that is here. It is a love that transcends all. And this I say thank you for, not to anyone, just as a state of gratitude and appreciation. It is a resonating factor of that good that already is, that I am, you are, God is expressing in our individual lives in relevant kind of ways. And so I let go to that. I surrender my way to that infinite expression's way as the way of my life. And so I let go, just allow God to do its perfect thing now. So it is. Amen.
There was a time in my life I thought I had to do it all for myself. I didn't know the grace of God was sufficient. I didn't know the love of God was at hand. But now I can say, if you are discouraged, struggling just to make it through another day, you've got to let go and this is what you have to say. Come on, Seaside. I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life and my
affirmation is, I live from love. Together, I live from love. Touch your heart and say it again. I live from love. Touch your heart and say it again. I live from love. One more time like you mean it. I live from love. And our song of grace.
I'm living in peace. I'm living my life for what I believe. Through joys and through fears, in this world I walk. God's grace shines on me and it shines on us all. We are living in grace. We are living in grace. We are living. We're living in love, we're living in peace. United we stand as one family. We honor all truth as together we walk. God's grace moves through me and it moves through us all. We are living in grace. We are living in grace.
Great day.